Welcome to the ESI Small Experiments podcast, where we have conversations with University of Groningen instructors to inquire about what they have been testing, tweaking, or trying out in their teaching and learning activities, and what they observed and learned about themselves and their students in the process. Our guest for episode 9 is Kasia Tych, tenure track assistant professor at the Groningen Biomolecular Sciences and Biotechnical Institute in the Faculty of Science and Engineering. Kasia studies experimental biophysics, using tools developed in physics to study biological molecules. Our conversation took place on April 7th, 2021, and has been edited for length. In this episode, Kasia shares her experiences as a new teacher at the RUF, specifically her reflections on the first-year bachelor physical chemistry course that she taught starting in February of this year. Kasia found that even in large classes of more than 150, there are still many ways to connect with students and help them learn challenging content in a deep and meaningful way through intentional scaffolding, a learning environment where it is safe to make mistakes, and a playful sense of humor. Welcome to the podcast, Kasia. It's really nice that you take some time to speak with us. And we met at the Ruchestone, and we were in a group together, you know, talking about the future of how things will go here at the Ruch next academic year as we transition through Corona. And you said you've been at the university here for just over a year now?
Yeah, that's right. So yeah. I started last March.
And that would be a challenging time to begin working at the RUF. Yeah, and so you were redesigning a course from sort of the ground up, or can you explain?
So the course previously always had a reputation as being one of the most difficult courses as part of that degree. And so a lot of people had to retake the course. It had a pretty low pass rate. And so the person who was teaching that course moved on to teach a different one. And so I was told that this would be the course that was being offered to me as my first one to have a go at, let's say. And yeah, it was. I was given an idea of what it would look like more or less in terms of, you know, what were the learning objectives and what were the topics covered. The previous lecturer was very kind in sharing materials with me of what he had taught.
Well, in a way, well, that's very challenging, but also kind of fun because you had a bit of creative license and how you could design it to work best for your style because every instructor is different. Yeah. But sorry, the course again was
Physical Chemistry 1. So it's the introduction basically to sort of the principles of how molecules interact with each other if they collide, for example, or how they interact with each other in general, how we model that, you know, everything ranging from the kinematic equations, like, you know, the equations of motion to looking at some simple molecular dynamics models and things like this. So it's definitely a physics approach to chemistry, I would say. And of course that suits me because I'm actually an electronic engineer, but you know, it's a similar kind of path, I suppose. And so, yeah, it definitely, you're right, gave me a lot of creative license to really put my stamp on it. And I did have a lot of fun preparing the materials, and I would have had even more fun if I'd had endless time to do it. But of course, it takes a lot of time investment. And yeah, I was definitely kind of like, okay, it's done now at some point.
And so it's mostly first-year students?
Yeah, mostly first-year, but of course there will be some people who were retaking it. So there were some second-years as well. And then, you know, they had all sorts of timetabling issues and whatever, but we made it work, yeah.
And which programs do they come to this course from? Are they all from one, or it's from different programs? Or?
It's the chemists and the chemical engineers. So I think, as far as I know, they do share a lot of common modules in the first year or two. But yeah, I think those are two separate programs, yeah.
And you said 180 students registered.
That was the absolute limit. I think in the end it was 166. And yeah, and of course of those, a certain number would show up regularly. So yeah, but 166, yeah. I think, was the final number. Yeah.
That's a big course. So that's always one of the questions we get in our department is like, how do you instruct and assess without really spending your whole life on this course with a course that size? So when you were planning, so like you said, you had the opportunity to get a little bit creative. Can you tell a little bit about some of the activities or things that you planned in that you were excited about but would work for a group that's a large class size?
So I think one of the big things you have to deal with in such a large class size, especially online, is that people feel a bit invisible. So you don't have their cameras switched on. There's no way of doing that. There's not enough bandwidth. So they could very easily kind of just drift off, wander off, I don't know, go to the kitchen, get a drink. And so my first challenge was to make sure that I could keep their attention and not lose them. And so I included a lot of really ridiculous things for that purpose. So every, you know, you get all these typical mathematical exercises, you know, a ball falls 10 meters from a building and it, by this time it reaches this velocity. So I thought, why a ball? Why can't it be, I don't know, a water bomb? Or why can't there be a hedgehog that's rolling around? Or why can't there be, I don't know, a woolly mammoth that you're figuring out the pressure that it exerts when it's standing on the earth? Or so I basically just got quite creative in all these examples. And I also didn't want to just be talking at them for 2 hours, right? I wanted them to actually feel like I wanted them to be included and interact with me. And so every slide I had, so I would have blank spaces for them to fill in as I was going. And those blank spaces were for them to fill in exercises. So I would say, okay, so we have this example, and I'd show them how, you know, I would calculate a certain thing, of course, using some ridiculous animal. And then on the next slide, I would say, okay, now it's your turn to try. And I would say, okay, so we have these parameters, we have these equations, like, how are you going to work this out? Can anyone tell me what the first step would be? And then very simply, just I would ask them to write in the chat box, like what their first step would be. And I would wait until really quite a lot of people had written something, and I wouldn't give away what the right answer was. I wouldn't give away any kind of like, I'd just be like, I'd be sort of expressing my excitement that people were saying things. I'd be like, oh, look, another response. That's great. But I wouldn't say, oh, but that looks a bit suspicious until I'd got enough answers. And then I'd say, okay, so that's interesting. We have some people saying this and some people saying this. And then what do we think, you know, what's going on here? And then some people would correct themselves and some people would correct each other. And then there'd be this kind of conversation going. And this from day one, like I established that this needed to be the case from the first lecture onwards, that they realized that, first of all, I'm not going to yell at anyone for giving a wrong answer, because that would be silly. And second of all, that I really wanted them to take part and that it made me happy. So I tried to really express that. And it really seemed to work. So I had incredible amounts of participation and interaction all the way through the whole entire course. And the numbers of people that were showing up to lectures, I of course have no comparison, but when I told my more experienced colleagues, they were all really amazed. So I think the strategy seems to have worked. But of course, as I said, this is the first time I'm doing this, so I have really no comparison to you know, how it could go. And I'm sure there are still many things that I could improve.
So I'm curious about a couple of things. So you said you left blank space in the slides for them to answer. So do you mean like they had copies of the slides and then they could type into the slides in that blank space? Or what do you mean by that?
Yeah, so I left it quite flexible. So what I did was before every lecture, I would upload like a handout with just the slide images, but with lots of things missing. Mm-hmm. And I would make it clear to them that, you know, I would go slowly whenever they need to fill something in. And they could either print them out if they want to do that, or they could fill them in on their computers. So they were PDFs, so you could edit them with Adobe or whatever PDF editor you have. Or yeah, I mean, if you have a tablet, of course, you can draw on it. They all sort of took their own approaches with that. I didn't dictate that. But of course, I realized that you need to be inclusive. So I didn't make this like an essential thing. It's just more like an additional tool. So I did afterwards upload the annotated versions of the slides for anybody who wasn't able to keep up or wanted to have, I don't know, like the correct solutions in case theirs weren't. So it was more just, so for example, when I have been in any lecture, I find that when I'm writing stuff down, it definitely helps, like not the whole time, because you also need to have interaction and thought, mm-hmm. but certainly to be able to make a few annotations, it kind of keeps my attention focused. It means that I feel like I'm doing something and I'm participating rather than kind of just, you know, drifting off and wondering what I'm going to have for lunch, basically.
Yeah, no, that's a powerful way of doing it. I like very much what you said about giving them permission to fail. And that you gave space for different answers. And then I loved what you said, that then they would start to correct themselves. And that's a great way of fostering critical thinking with your students, is when you allow them to answer and there are different answers, and then they have to think about, well, hold on a second, is my answer right or is their answer right? And they kind of have to go back through things to figure out, did that person go wrong somewhere or did I, and how do we find what the problem is and which is actually correct. So how did you make sure that, like, because what I hear from some other teachers is they ask people to put things in the chat and they'll wait and only one or two people will, and then they get frustrated and move on. But how did you develop that expectation so that they actually would interact with you?
I don't know. It could be a combination of a few things. So on the first day, my colleague had actually set up the session for me, and he'd opened up a whiteboard. And so the students were kind of doodling and scribbling and writing things. And I was like, oh, this is great, because they're actually having some kind of creative output and ability to kind of communicate with each other. And it's anonymous, right? You don't know who's written what. So it's kind of fun in that way. And so that became a tradition. So at the beginning of every session, I would open up a whiteboard and I would write, hello, how's everyone doing? And like, they would start to tell me, you know, and they would ask me questions like, I don't know, how was your weekend, or what's your favorite tea, or I don't know. But it developed a kind of maybe an approachability, I'm not sure. But it's certainly, we definitely had fun, like when we were waiting for people to come into the classroom. There were some quite talented artists actually in the group who would draw really amazing sketches on this whiteboard. Wow. And so, yeah, we kind of developed this rapport where they would make little jokes and I would comment on it. And I think that at least contributed to this feeling of approachability. And I think also the fact that I made sure that people felt okay if they didn't understand something to ask me, because I think a lot of the time people are shy to answer questions if they're not sure of their answer. So I certainly remember from university where, like, I would only put my hand up to answer something if I absolutely 100% knew that that was the answer. Mm-hmm. If I had just an idea, then I would never say anything because, you know, it's super embarrassing, right? And so I would, first of all, take them really step by step through everything, because I think it can be so easy for people to get lost if you're going too fast, if you're explaining a new concept. So I would go step by step. I would explain things from at least two different angles, because I know that people think differently. And I think really, judging from their responses, they were really kind of coming along with me. And, you know, I would make sure that there were some really easy things at the beginning so that people would get warmed up and used to the idea of answering questions. And then I would make it maybe a little bit more challenging as I went through, but people would then keep going and people would make guesses sometimes. And then they would say, oh, I'm guessing, I'm not sure, it might be this. And they would ask some really excellent questions, things that I had never thought of. You know, this was like our discussions would trigger some completely, you know, obscure scientific ideas that were fantastic. And it was really great to see them kind of start to be creative in their approach to this. But I think for sure, yeah, these two things. So like the ability to kind of develop some kind of dialogue, which of course is very difficult online. And this making sure that you don't immediately dive in at the deep end. I think those were the two kind of key things, I would say.
Yeah, that's really nice. And I mean, I think sometimes we overlook the power of just that casual conversation at the beginning and allowing people to feel comfortable with interacting, even if it's in a silly way. And I know our job is not entertainment, but we do work with people, humans, right? Like that's the bottom line. So we need to incorporate, I think, always some of that caring and human element into what we're doing, even if it's just 5 minutes at the beginning. It can really help people and foster more interaction throughout the rest of the course. So at the Ruhestein, one of the things that you really captured my attention was you were talking about how you incorporated questions on almost every slide. So you're talking already about the blank spaces, but were there any other ways that you used questions? And how did you sort of structure that to make sure you asked them and gave time for those answers and were still able to cover everything?
So I would always start each lecture off, of course, if it was applicable, with a kind of more in-depth philosophical question of why would we even want to do this? Like, why are we learning this subject? What is it useful for? Where does it apply? And so that would be a quite open question that you can ask and say to people, you know, what do you think? And I would get really amazing answers, actually. I was super impressed. And I think because to that kind of question, there are no wrong answers, then that already starts to trigger people somehow to start kind of thinking and interacting. I would very often also use animations on my slides where I gradually reveal things, so step by step. So I would say, okay, so I want to calculate this thing, what's the first thing I need to do? And then they would tell me, and then I would uncover that and say, yeah, indeed, this is what I did, and I used this and this method. And then I would wait a bit, let people kind of write it down or ask any questions they needed, and then I would say, okay, is everyone with me, is everyone happy with this step? And if they were, then I would move on, and if anyone said, no, actually I didn't get why you did this bit here, then I would go back and explain it again. And people really actually did say things like that. So it was very good for me to see what I had explained in a less than optimal way. Sometimes I could already spot it as I was saying it. I would be like, no, let me rephrase this. but sometimes I needed somebody to say, I think this wasn't entirely clear. And then, yeah, just by doing this gradual revealing, I think that very much led to interactions. And of course, you can do that on every slide if you really sort of take your time. And I think that my general approach is rather than cramming like a huge amount of material into a lecture and then having 90% of the people be lost, I prefer to cover less material but make sure that almost everybody, or hopefully everybody, actually is with me. And I did have some students say to me that they were a little bit concerned that they might not be well prepared for subsequent courses, and I had to reassure them that they actually have met all the learning objectives. It's just that it didn't feel as painful, maybe. but people definitely were saying like, oh, but this is so easy, like why was I afraid of this, and oh, I'm enjoying physics for the first time, or I'm like, you know. And I think taking the bite out of it by really kind of going a little bit more slowly and a little bit more carefully and really making sure you kind of include everyone, that's, for me at least, that was my goal.
Well, that's something that I always advocate for, is rather than always thinking that we have to cover content, is that we actually need to uncover the content. So I love that you were even doing that very literally, that you would just give them little, yeah, bite-sized pieces. But that gives them actually process and thinking time to sort of examine their process inside their head. To say, okay, am I kind of following along at the same way? And then it also allows them to identify maybe where they're making errors. And also for you to, as you said, see where maybe there was a bit of a gap in understanding that you could then readdress.
Yeah.
So that's really nice. Okay, so you would uncover material and then you would have blank spots for them to fill in. So really engaging them in the process if they chose to do so. And then the questions on the slides.
Yeah, so the material was one thing that I would uncover, but also actual questions. So we would go through exercises in the same way. So uncovering one bit at a time, and I would ask them to tell me in the chat what their answer that they got was. And again, it would be the same process where some of them would get something different and they'd be like, hang on a second. But what's amazing is that towards the end, of course, I occasionally had mistakes on my lecture slides because that happens. And towards the end, they were picking out my mistakes. So they were saying to me, hang on, oh, you put a negative there where there shouldn't be one. And I was like, yes, you're going to do better on the exam than I would now. Like,
and that can be a amazing. Nice strategy too, is, and I've seen some instructors do this really well, where they purposefully make mistakes and then they ask the students to uncover those.
I did it by accident. I should have been smart and said like, oh yeah, no, I totally did this on purpose. Yeah. But no, I'm too painfully honest for that.
But when they have to deconstruct it to find where the error is, that's actually really powerful learning as well.
Yeah, no, now that I've fixed all the errors on my slides, I will actually start to include some on purpose where I know where they are and ask that, because I agree. I think that's a very good method. And I mean, the fact that I did it by accident and it worked is proof of that, I think.
Now, something else you mentioned was that you use a lot of humor as a way of keeping your students sort of interested and engaged. Can you talk a little bit more about how you did that kind of thing?
Yeah, so it was mostly in these examples, you know, where you have, I had, for example, a platypus as my creature of choice to demonstrate various aspects of Newton's laws. And the platypus would, for example, slide along a frictionless surface and then it would say, wee. And, you know, and of course, if you want to show action and reaction, then the platypus can collide with a giant jelly. And that's also, you know, utterly ridiculous. But people seem to actually respond very well to that. And so I, for example, my favorite example was probably using a beaver with its favorite little blue ball. And it was either pushing this blue ball up a hill or the ball was rolling down the hill towards the beaver. And that was demonstrating, the Gibbs free energy. So this basically like whether something is energetically favorable or not. And so the students seemed to like this so much that the next lecture, like a large percentage of them had the beaver picture as their profile pictures. I was like, okay. Apparently this was popular. So I think, first of all, yeah, I'm just naturally silly. I can't take myself seriously at all. But it also really seemed to work with engaging the students. It's not just for my own entertainment.
So. But it is kind of fun. And what's nice about that is that as humans, our brains are hardwired for story. So even though maybe it seems like a bit funny or silly, it gave their brains sort of a story to hook onto. And it's almost guaranteed that they are going to remember that in a much more deep way, because they'll be able to bring up that picture of the beaver and the blue ball than if you just explained it as the concept itself without any kind of imagery to go along with it. So that's actually a very clever way of doing it, but also kind of fun.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to hear you say that, because I was a little bit concerned that it would somehow, I don't know, go against professional regulations or something. But no, it was definitely appreciated. And I used the same kind of level in the exam also to help them to relax and feel familiar. So I would use also lots of, you know, little creatures in the exam questions that would be reminiscent of the ones that they'd seen in the lectures. So first of all, to trigger the memory, but second of all, to just kind of make them smile a bit, because I think when you smile you automatically relax a bit.
Indeed. Yeah, and we need people to be relaxed in order to feel safe to learn, and to be open to it, or especially like you said on an exam. Can you talk about your exam? Like, did you design it any differently than you would have for like face-to-face or physical delivery because of the online format?
I honestly have no real comparison, but so I mean the exam was done in person, so it was a typical, you know, paper exam. This was something that I was advised to do because apparently a lot of the students don't feel that in their homes they have a good environment to do the exam, So maybe they have noisy housemates, or they don't have a stable internet connection, or you know, any other reason. And so it wasn't such a different exam to a traditional exam that I've seen before, but I definitely designed it very much to match the course. And so the examples that I'd given in the lectures were phrased in exactly the same way as the questions on the exam. So that meant that it was consistent throughout. And I did the same, I coordinated with my TAs on the tutorials, such that, again, the same kind of language would be used, the same kind of level would be used. So I think consistency there is key, because otherwise, yeah, you go into an exam and you see lots of unfamiliar things, and I can imagine that would be very stressful.
Yeah, and the idea of an exam is to actually assess the learning in the course, not to trick people.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think consistency is definitely huge. So they still came to Aletta Jakobs Hall, or where?
That's where it took place. And I was asked a lot of questions about, how to do the COVID testing beforehand. And I was surprised that they didn't know, actually. So apparently that information isn't being super well distributed. But I told them what I did know, which was that they need to make an appointment if they want to get tested. And that I, of course, encourage them to get tested if they don't mind and if they can, because that way everyone feels safer. But I also said that I completely understand if people don't feel safe going in person, and that I would probably also not, I didn't tell them that, but I would probably also not feel safe going in person to do an exam during a pandemic. So, of course, there are options to do the resit, and I think the resit will have to be online just because there are so many people who are still abroad. Mm-hmm. I think, and actually that's also why I made the exam open book, because I knew that it would be fair then, so that the resit would also be, of course, open book, and it would be sort of an advantage then to the people doing the resit if they were able to do that and the people in person were not. So yeah, it was a lot of thought went into it, for sure, but yeah, I hope that I did the right thing. You never know.
So you designed this course specifically for online.
Yeah.
But if it is given again next February, we could be in a completely different situation. Do you find that because you designed for online fully delivery, that it's easier to transfer it back to a face-to-face situation? I always find myself that if it's designed for face-to-face, it's much harder to move online. But if you design for online, it's easier to move backward into a physical environment. What do you think about that?
Yeah, so of course, again, I have no comparison apart from my own past experiences of, when I did my degree. But I've thought about this a lot already, and I think that it should be fine to transfer back into in-person, as long as we maintain this ability of students to both like interact in a chat box and anonymously. So a lot of the times on the whiteboard, this worked very well during tutorials, and we were doing practice exam questions. We let people type things onto the whiteboard anonymously, and then they would ask questions that they would never ask on the chat because that has your name on it. And so there were a lot of people who were shy about asking certain questions because they thought that they would be obvious or that they should know it by now, quote. Mm-hmm. And I would say, first of all, if you don't know it yet, that's partially my fault. It's not you. And second of all, yeah, let's keep this. So I think if there's a way of basically integrating some kind of environment that allows that whilst teaching in person. So having everyone on their laptops, tablets, whatever, that would be very helpful in terms of maintaining this kind of participation of a lot of people at the same time. Because I think if you're asking people to raise hands, that causes all sorts of problems for the majority who aren't super confident.
Yeah, sometimes the online environment can make it feel easier for people to respond because it gives them the ability sometimes to have a bit more time to think through things rather than put up their hand and then all eyes are on you.
Yeah.
So having the anonymous aspect, I think is nice as well, like you said.
Just remembering back to my university days again, I'm talking about this as if it was many centuries ago, but I definitely used to get very anxious. I would put my hand up and I would think I had the right answer. I would still get this kind of pumping heart sensation and this, you know, all the blood going to my face. And then I'd worry that I'd say something utterly ridiculous and forget my name and, you know. And so for people like me.
Which is most people, I think.
I think it's really essential if you want to keep them from either drifting off and getting bored or from just stopping showing up. Then you need to find some way of roping them in and being like, come on, more people know this, come on. And I really think that these online environments do provide that. And to be able to bring that into a real in-person classroom where they can, you know, it'll be so much nicer to see their faces and, you know, be able to, you know, interact with them and smile at them and whatever. But to have that combined with this online, this kind of hybrid approach, I think is certainly very beneficial, and also enables people who are not able to attend the class in person to still join as well. So there are many benefits there. And as we look at increasing student numbers, then that could become very relevant, I think.
Nice. So just to sort of round things off, if you could give any advice to someone maybe who's right now having to design their course for September delivery in an online format in a large group, what would you say to them?
Take nothing for granted. I think everything that you think is obvious is probably not, and you really need to go step by step and make sure that everybody's following each step, because very often if you lose somebody really early on, they lose all of the benefit of the rest of the lecture. So I think, yeah, assume nothing is my my big tip. But also, yeah, I think include some fun elements, show that you're a person and that you're all on the same team, you all want these people to learn and they want to learn. Yeah, I think that's another important aspect too.
Yeah, we're all in this together, right?
Yeah.
Educational Support and Innovation, or ESI, is the central instructional support team for all educators at the University of Groningen. To find out more about the services and resources we have made available during this interesting time in the world and in academic education, please visit edusupport.ruch.nl.